Hello, welcome to episode 2 of ATG, All Things Geek. Today we'll be having a quick look at Mars Attacks Judge Dredd. Talking about Ninja Turtle toys with John. We're going to be looking at the new Power Rangers movie trailer.
Yeah.
And also we're going to be talking about the Walking Dead TV show. So, welcome! This week, we are looking at Mars Attack Judge Dredd. Mars Attack was a great 90s film, which we can all agree.
Yep.
Starred Michael J. Fox in one of his last prominent film roles.
Yep.
So this is quite a quick look at Judge Dredd and Mars Attacks. It's a crossover graphic novel. I think it's IDW. Yep, IDW, who do a lot of the crossover stuff nowadays. Actually responsible for the new Transformers Robot Disguise and More Than Meets the Eye comic book lines. First of all, I absolutely love this, just because it's one of the kind of weirdest crossovers I could think of. Judge Dredd, which in my head will always sound like Sylvester Stallone, despite the fact it's kind of an awful movie, but it's awfully awesome, if that makes sense.
It's enjoyable!
Yeah.
It's enjoyable!
That's what I mean, it's awful but campy and brilliant at the same time.
In 1995, we didn't know any better.
I knew you'd say that.
We're not going to talk about the remake either, because that was just terrible.
What? No, it wasn't, Tom!
Get out!
Don't touch
me! Leave!
I hated the remake.
Right. Oh, well, the one that was really faithful to the adaptation, where he didn't take off his helmet within 5 seconds of the film starting. Oh, it didn't have enough catchphrases. Get out!
Tom, just leave.
I am a huge Judge Dredd fan. Absolutely love Judge Dredd. Don't think he gets enough love.
We're also running applications for a new presenter.
Yeah. So send us your thoughts on Judge Dredd, and we'll tell you what. That was a fantastic film that was made with Carl Urban doing some of the best chin acting I've ever seen ever. Would love to see it as a Netflix.
He is a slightly off face.
Yes, I agree with that.
It was dark, it was gritty, it was what Judge Dredd 2000 AD, it was what.
It was what it was meant to be.
Mega City 1 looked awful. But I loved that's why about it. Needs to look.
Do you know what I absolutely loved about it? Is you could have paused that film at any time and freeze framed it, and it would have looked like a shot from a comic book.
Yeah.
Similar to what they did with Sin City a few years beforehand. And I think the people are aware of what a comic strip looks like. But it was just, it was a brilliant film. But sorry, you're talking about this.
Yes, the book. Right?
Yeah, sorry, it's easy to get straight. We will actually talk about Judge Dredd probably on next season, maybe. Yeah.
Maybe we should do a Judge Dredd episode.
And Tom won't be here.
Yeah,
we'll do a Judge Dredd episode.
And you can teach me.
Dedicated to Tom.
No,
we haven't got that long.
No, Judge Dredd 2000 AD.
Right, so the crossover comic, it's kind of like the old basic story where, you know, the Mars Attacks come over, the aliens come over, try and invade. As always, you know, you got Side Judge Anderson as well. Some horrible 2000 AD kind of humour there, with a guy being probed up to be honest, which, let's be honest, is the kind of horrible thing you'd only see in 2000 AD, and also the gross humour that is Mars Attacks. So it's a kind of great crossover. I'd recommend picking it up. You can get it for not very much, like, money at all, really. Any questions, really, about it? I know I haven't really gone too much in the story, I don't want to give too much away. I'll be honest, there's not really too much to the story, it's content. It's kind of what you think it's going to be.
It's Judge Dredd versus Mars Attack.
Yeah, the aliens come down, there's a bit of kind of the old shape-shifting, just like in the film, you know, they disguise themselves as humans, sometimes not very well, and they get wind of it, there's a big battle, Judge Dredd says some of his amazing lines, Side Judge Anderson does some of her psychic stuff, and we're all good. So
when was this released? When was this first published?
Do you know what, I don't know. This is a kind of a compendium, so this was I think it was like a 4-part like series.
Right.
Like they did. The funny thing is actually, Mars Attacks versus type thing is kind of almost like a sub line its own right. Because they've done a couple, because I really want to get there's a Mars Attacks and Transformers crossover as well, which that in its own right I think would be amazing. But I think they just did a thing where they started Mars Attacks and everything. Like there's we will do also an episode on crossovers in comics and graphic novels at some point, because there's just some ridiculous ones like Predator and Tarzan. Which I would love to see, or Predator and Archie, actually, that'd be a good one. Like, yeah, it's crazy.
Like when the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles met the Power Rangers.
Yes! Oh my god, what a great episode.
No, it wasn't.
It was!
Which is kind of happening in this episode.
Yes.
You're looking at the Power Ranger trailer.
Horrendous, glittery, over-the-top Fox Kids, tedious old nonsense.
There's no female
can
turtle.
Can I just say, can I just ask a question? Why did she have, like, breasts.
Turtle boots.
That just didn't
because
make sense to me.
That's the only way, you know. Why did RC in Transformers have like a weird breastplate?
Yeah,
she's a robot.
Why did George Clooney have bat nipples?
Yeah,
Yeah.
These questions, if you know the answer.
Please.
Or even better, what's your most bizarre TV thing in regards to what's the most bizarre thing you think you've seen on a character or
most bizarre costume or character choice?
You think that's not right?
Yeah.
Like Colin Baker's outfit as in Doctor Who as the Sixth Doctor. That multicoloured monstrosity.
I kind of think that was just like, oh, damn it, we didn't design a costume and we are filming in 5 minutes.
Yeah. Is Oxfam still open?
What's he wearing? Let's take some of that. Come on, you've got too many layers on. So what? Give me those shoes. That's what I think happened there.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic crossover comic. It's a lot of fun. So it's not very expensive. Definitely recommend picking it up.
Out of 10?
I'll give it 7.
7 out of 10.
Yeah, it's short, sweet, funny, but it's not so memorable that you go, oh, I'm going to read it again soon. So, yeah.
Brilliant. Awesome.
Okay, so now I'm going to talk to you about some of the rarer Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles toys that are out there. If you see them, pick them up, because they could be worth something. They more than likely are worth something. If I ask my glamorous assistant to just pass me one of the four you see up the top there.
Let's go for one of the four.
Yeah, let's go for that one. Okay, so Raphael. I don't know if you can see that from here. Tom, if you'd like to walk that over to the camera.
Raphael.
These were part of the Sewer Hero series, they were called. There were so many different forms of Turtles figures throughout the years. There's so many different variants out there. To find the original four with their weapons is quite hard to do these days, and to have one mint on a card is probably about 80 to 120 quid, subject to the corners not being framed. I recently saw, some people pay mad prices on eBay, but I recently saw a boxed Bebop, that was from the first wave of Turtles figures in 88, go on eBay for 200 quid, mint.
Wow.
It's mad what Turtles stuff does. I love Turtle stuff because as a kid, it covered everything. You know, there were Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles placemats, playing cards, pool floats, cutlery. There were sun visors for your car. There were mouse mats. There was games. There were board games. There were jigsaws. There was obviously you got the toys.
Didn't they have a thing with Pizza Hut for a while as well?
Yeah, they did a promotional.
Pretty much like Frozen nowadays.
Yeah. They did a promotional thing with Pizza Hut in 1990 when the first film came out, the live action movie, which is easily one of my most favourite films of all time. It's just fantastic.
Definitely do an episode on that.
Yeah, some people disagree with me on that, but it is. It's you guys talking amongst yourselves. You haven't seen
I'm
it.
I'm asking Tom if he remembers the Turtles.
We will disclose our ages at some point as well. The first Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles toy I ever got was I didn't have any of the figures for a long time, but I had a speedboat. I had the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles speedboat that had like a little. A little ski at the bottom, like a singular ski that lifted up and the boat just went like that. And over the years I pulled it apart and ripped it to pieces. But it was absolutely amazing. And then to buy this stuff brand new, was quite expensive to do. So when I was younger I used to go to a lot of car boot sales and pick all this stuff up there. And that's how my collection started. So it was mainly, I remember buying I was probably about 16 at the time. And I bought a job lot of a crate, probably that big, that wide, that deep, full of Ghostbusters, the real Ghostbusters, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles toys.
Okay, but that was the cartoon, wasn't it?
And that was back in the days when people didn't know what stuff was worth at car boot sales. Mm-hmm. So you'd offer someone like a fiver for the box, and they were more than happy to get rid of it. And this box has stayed with me ever since, and ever since then, I've got crates upon crates and upon crates of Turtles figures.
What about this one?
Again, part of the Sewer Hero series. The one I haven't got there. There's a Donatello. There's a Donatello in a scuba diver's outfit. Which I have got at home, but these were just some of the ones I picked up.
He's got fish on his arms and legs.
He has. The nice thing...
What happened? Set falling down.
Don't
you look at
they
that?
They didn't just make custom moulds of these. Each figure had a slightly different smile to it. You know, they put sunglasses on some of them. And if Tom takes it up to the camera again,
of course.
There's lots of different little details that they go to, you know, they go to town on.
I did see a cassette Walkman on the one that the first turn, yeah. Which is great because any kid who now picks up at a boot sale or something is going to look at that and think it's some kind of weird alien device,
yeah.
Or they'll be like, oh, that's a shield generator or something.
But it's what we had.
Yeah, that's what we had. Yeah.
Growing up. the thing that bugged me was, you know, I absolutely adored the Turtles for their individuality. I thought it was absolutely fantastic, all the different lines that they did. But sometimes they did go too far with it. They just went absolutely too far with it, and they just think this has got to come to an end at some point. They were doing Transformer Turtles.
I had to turn into a cement truck.
Yeah, they did flip heads of Bebop and Rocksteady, which were anti-mutagen ones. So it went back to their original human form, which were fantastic. Because they even did the hands as well, even the hands flipped back. But they did a Leonardo that turned into a fire truck. They did a Donatello that turned into a sports car. They did a Master Splinter, which turned into it's going to bug me. It turned into like some sort of vehicle, anyway.
Which one was... Might have been Raphael, or it was like Raphael or Michelangelo. It turned into like a weird cement truck thing. But the thing is, as a kid, it was like impossible to transform.
Next to probably, as I've mentioned before, the Channel 6 news van, another holy grail of mine would be to have an original Technodrome. There were two Technodromes released. There was a mini version, which, you know, a lot of people got for Christmas. But if you were very, very privileged, you got the one that came in a massive box. And I know... Over the years, your memory can deceive you as to thinking, oh, these things were huge when we were kids. No, I saw one recently at a toy fair, and it is huge, you know, and I want one badly. Is there anything you guys would like to ask me specifically about the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles line?
Is this one based off Han Solo?
No.
But it's a shame, because that would have been an awesome crossover.
That is a street punk Leonardo.
Ah, the waistcoat and obviously the bandana, underneath the...
Underneath the mask.
Yeah. I have a quick question about the Ninja Turtles.
Yeah, go on.
So, well, we obviously said about the Turtles having loads of different iterations. Yeah. Now, did a lot of the enemies go through... So you had, like, the sports ones. They said then there was, like, the sewer team and stuff like that. Did you always get, like, another variation of Beat Rocksteady, Splinter, you know... All of these kind of characters, Shredder, like, you know... Were there all these different versions of the enemies as well?
Or
was it literally... Did you just end up with... 1,001 Turtle characters and no baddies for them to fight.
You ended up with 1,001 Turtles characters and very few baddies for them to fight. So you did end up with, like I said, they did a Shredder, a mutated Shredder from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, The Secret of the Ooze.
Yeah.
So they did a mutated Shredder from that. They also did, they obviously, as I mentioned, the Fliphead, Bebop and Rocksteadies. There was also, which are very rare to get hold of, which are also a bit strange and a bit exploitative. There was a Nazi Bebop.
Wow.
Right? In a sort of, you know, in a Second World War Nazi outfit. And there was a Rocksteady dressed in some sort of, again, some sort of Cold War kind of outfit. They were very weird, and they came out in the sort of early 90s.
Were they one of those ones that got pulled from shelves in some countries?
I don't know. I don't know whether
just
they
so you
are.
Can see the street punk doing a very dramatic pose there.
What? Do you want to do the scuba?
Oh, scuba as well.
Yeah, scuba.
The thing I'll never forget as well, I mean, like, I loved the Turtle Range when I was a
kid.
Absolutely loved it. And it's an era gone by, because I remember at Christmas time how popular they were one Christmas. I can't remember, it must have been like maybe 88, 89, something like that. And they were so popular that there was like a release date for them, and people were queuing and queuing and queuing at Toys R Us and walking out with like carts full of like these turtle figures.
Yeah.
And I was very privileged because my mum and dad were able to get for me Leonardo, Raphael, Michelangelo, a foot soldier.
Foot soldier was part of the first wave.
Foot soldier, yeah. That's what I mean. And we got all of them, but the one I couldn't get hold of was Donatello. I couldn't get hold of it because he sold out. And it came around to Christmas and everything, and someone said something to me along the lines of that my nan had got me the Donatello, and I was like, get in there, yes. Got there, all the rest of it, anticipation. Opened up, and it was one of their knockoffs. Where they had got the same mould, so they were the exact same figures, but the plastic was just a
slightly
bit darker,
different colour,
and the plastic was, you know, the arms popped off quickly, and
Les Ninjas Tortuous on the sides,
proper market job. But it was back in the day where counterfeit toys were really something special in himself, and I kept it, and I played with it, and he was my Donatello. I didn't go out and get an official Donatello, because I had Donatello. He had a darker shade of green, and his weapons were a slightly different colour, but hey, he had a purple medal.
Donatello.
It's nice as well, because obviously with the recent movies coming out, the toy shelves are full of Turtle toys again.
Yeah, you know, and it opens up a whole new generation to people of Turtles fans. Because some kid's going to come along and say, you know, the new Turtles movie was the greatest thing that I've ever seen. I really, really loved it. Regardless of whether it was directed by Michael Bay or not. That's a different question. Mr. Explosion.
Special effects.
But, I should do that. Just throw some special effects out. And just little explosions come out of my hand. But, you know, a 7-year-old goes and watches that. Then that 7-year-old will probably have a parent of a generation that remembers the Turtles from the first time around. Go, well, if you love them this much, come and check out the DVDs.
Yeah.
Which annoyingly still have not been released in this country. You've only got season 1 and 2 available on DVD in this country, which is a real pain. Unless you have a multi-region DVD player, and I recently inherited the complete series 1 to 10 from America in the shape of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles van.
What?
Which I will be unveiling very soon.
Excellent. Thanks very much, John.
That's all right, no problem. Thank you.
Oh, actually, before we go, I have a quick question.
Go on. And Tom hasn't asked a question either, so it's to be right.
Okay, very quick one. Why was it Hero Turtles here and Ninja Turtles elsewhere?
Very, very quick response. It's down to one woman who divides opinion across the world. And that would be Thatcher.
I was going to say Debbie McGee, but yeah.
No, not Debbie McGee. Thatcher. Anything. Kids programming had to be treated with kid gloves. When you're a TV producer, you had to think to yourself, oh, we have to be very careful about what we're bringing in. You know, Thundercats just slipped the radar because it sort of was on its title. But if you watch Thundercats, it's actually quite a dark.
Well, the
piece
first
of anime.
Episode, they're all naked.
Their home planet's just been destroyed, and all their loved ones have died.
Yeah, and they're all naked in a spaceship alone with an old man.
Ulysses 31, another classic example. Like, his family are dead floating in space, and he has to go and... Anyway, but there was lots of threats around the time from Japan and the Yakuza, and... The word, that light's going to go again, the word ninja being associated to terrorism.
Wow.
As simple as that. So they changed it from ninja to hero. They had a whole new theme tune done, recorded by a different artist, I believe, as well.
Oh, I would have loved if they just went, Teenage Ninja, Hero Turtles.
Yeah. And also, if you look at the opening credits of Hero and Ninja, there's a lot cut out. Purely because I don't quite know my history on this, but I have reason to believe that we may not have got, I could be completely wrong, so I apologise, but I don't think we got most episodes from season 1. Purely because, there it goes again, purely because Michelangelo's nunchucks were being used. If you look at the episodes and remember, think back to when you were a kid, how often did Michelangelo use his nunchucks? Very, very rarely.
Normally just said pizza.
Yeah? Yeah, very, very rarely. And it's because they were an illegal weapon. I don't know whether they still are to this day, but at the time they were an illegal weapon. So if in most of Series 1, he's using them. He uses them to wrap around bad guys' feet, to chop their heads off foot soldiers. You know, but most of those episodes got cut. And there's a lot from the opening credits which is cut as well. Lots from the opening credits.
My t-shirt says ninja.
I know it does.
That's like a kid in school.
I've just seen
my t-shirt says ninja.
I've just seen it. I've got ninja on my t-shirt. There you go, look at that. Gonna show. See?
It's all about show.
It is all about Jay. Just some funny things as well, which I will do a little thing about. But there was occasional sort of cock-ups with the animation within the Teenage Turtles series. Like, all of a sudden, it would be Raphael's voice coming out of Leonardo's mouth.
And you say Transformers as well. Some of them
just,
are brilliant.
Or sometimes they would just not move their mouths at all, and there would be just someone talking, and you go, that's weird. So anyway, that answers your question. It was pretty much down to Thatcher and the government at the time. And the word ninja not being used in anything because it was associated to terrorism.
Government!
Yes. And even in the later repeats, they were repeated. The last time the original series was repeated was in about 2000, 2001.
Was that Fox Kids?
No, it was on Bravo, the short-lived Sky Channel Bravo, in the afternoons. Because I remember coming home from work to watch it. Yeah, but... Yeah, Tom, have you got a question for me?
I've noticed in your books that you have laying around here.
Yep.
You've got an encyclopedia as well, haven't you?
Somewhere, but.
And the Turtle Annual as well.
Yep.
So just tell us a little bit, very very briefly, about what these books mean in with regards to the merchandise of Ninja Turtles.
From a personal aspect, especially like the Magic Sword of Nowhere, which is the book at the back there, they were part of a range of books which were aimed at junior readers, so larger print and so forth. So I was about 25 when I read those. I learned to read with a lot of those books. They were fantastic.
When
I was 25.
When I was 25.
Oh, I just say Hero Turtles.
Yeah. Because they were made for the UK market. So all the merchandising had to be made for the UK market as well. So everything was changed from here. It cost them an absolute fortune, but it paid dividends, as we know, battling in Toys R Us, around that time. And do you know what? Another thing that really annoyed me was the fact that we're all from Essex, and the nearest Toys R Us was Ipswich back then, wasn't it?
Yeah,
it was Ipswich.
Yeah, it was the
arse end of nowhere. So.
Sorry for everyone that lives in Ipswich.
Yeah,
it's a magical place, though. There is.
You can move from Ipswich anytime you want.
My dad lives in Ipswich.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Tom. Yeah. Tom's corner.
To answer your question, the books on a personal level mean a lot to me. Mm. But I now think I see anything with that kind of iconic logo, mm-hmm. and I just go. I've got to get me some of that.
So are there books with Ninja Turtles on there?
There's a few.
Are they quite rare?
They're not rare. They were just sort of later editions because the whole Hero Ninja thing got lifted. So I think we carried on with the series being under Hero, but the merchandising went over to Ninja.
Okay.
Because the popularity waned a bit.
Yeah.
And that's about it, really.
Amazing.
Welcome to this section, then we're going to talk a little bit about TV. The Walking Dead Season 7 is well underway now, and I just want to have a quick chat about Episode 1, mainly because it was so anticipated. There was so much speculation, so many fan theories that drifted around. I mean, even if you weren't a Walking Dead fan, you couldn't get away from it. It was everywhere that you looked.
Totally.
So, yes, there are going to be spoilers in this quick bit, but if you've not seen Season 7, Episode 1 by now, by the time this goes live... then you're not really going to care anyway. So, obviously, we wrapped up on Season 6 with Negan having the surviving characters of the season on their knees with him, eeny, meeny, miny, moeing, then with Lucille, his baseball bat wrapped in barbed wire, deciding who was going to get the bat. And they left us on a cliffhanger with the camera playing a point of view with the person falling down. And then we were left for months to speculate and to anticipate and all those kind of things about who had been killed. There were some fantastic fan theories, floating around the internet. I'd be a liar if I said that I didn't get caught up in it all trying to guess. There was things about, this angle, and then there was that person and that person and that person and all the rest of it. But I just want to have a quick chat, very, very briefly, about the actual episode itself and what it meant for me. I mean, it was easily one of the... episodes on television that had me on the edge of my seat, and I know that's a saying that's bandied around a lot, but I literally was there watching it in silence. It was like watching...
Paint dry?
No. John's not a fan of Walking Dead, so... No, but it wasn't. It was so... There was so much to it.
Makes me so angry.
So let's go. Abraham. Abraham was obviously the first to get the bat. This in itself was really quite gory and was quite painful to watch.
But one of the best lines of the entire episode.
But one of the best lines, which as well I've heard that he completely improvised.
Wouldn't be surprised.
No, completely.
If you're going to go off the show, go off his
stuff. Oh no, tell a lie. It might not have been that he improvised, but he improvised the peace sign. Just as he was about to get it, he throws the peace sign like that to one of the other characters, and that was improvised. But seeing him, I mean, he was a character that, okay, he was a secondary character, but he was one of my favourites to watch. I loved his one-liners, I loved his quirkiness. There was something quite special about him. So to see him die was quite a disappointment for me. But completely guessed it, mainly because the arrow through the eye in a couple of episodes earlier in season 6 was obviously Abraham in the comic book, so it was pretty obvious that he was going to meet his demise soon.
So it's interesting to say, I agree, like, I actually called it with who was going to die in the episode. Mm-hmm. Slight reason, my reason for picking Abraham was because I actually thought there wasn't much more they could do with his character arc. No. I actually thought his death would add more character arc for Eugene. I thought losing him would actually gain more story than keeping him alive. I didn't think... Yeah, they took away the arrow in the eye. I'm sure that's like a Skyrim joke we can make there, but like they took away that he gets it.
Yep.
They took away that, there wasn't really much you could do with it. I don't see what
he had come full circle. Yeah, I mean, he really had. He came in, he exploded in, he done what he did. Obviously, the whole story of him and Eugene, and it had come to a head with the whole Bullet Factory and Eugene becoming this new person. And that was, you know, seeing that and seeing him getting bludgeoned over and over and over again was pretty intense. And then they went and killed Glenn. Like, that to me was mental. I was totally thrown. I mean, there was rumours that there was two people getting killed, but once Abraham had done and I'd kind of got over it, I was like, okay, this is safe now, I can watch the rest of the episode. And then Daryl had his outburst, and then for a second you thought, shit, something's going to happen to Daryl. But... because obviously he's not a character in a comic book, but then Negan tops Glenn off just as a warning to the rest of them, and that was brutal.
So I'm not quite familiar with Walking Dead. I've seen a few episodes.
Then don't say anything. We're at season 7 here, Tom. Don't start throwing things in the mix. Right, go on, fire.
But for the people who might not have watched it, who is Negan to the group? He's the main villain in season 7.
He's the main villain in season 7. He's one of the
So what is his story?
He's basically in charge of a group called the Saviors, which is another group of surviving people, but they're very bad. Let's put it that way. Without giving too much away, they are bad news. And Negan,
that's a very PG way of saying it. I like it.
It is a very PG way of saying it, but he is bad news. He is the head of this group called the Saviors, and our survivors running into the Saviors and Negan was obviously something that was very much anticipated in the TV show, following the comics.
Great casting choice, by the way, for Negan.
Yeah.
Fantastic casting choice, absolutely spot on.
Who plays Negan?
The deaths of season 7, episode 1 happened to Glenn. You know, Lucille goes across his head. He can't talk. His eye bulges out of his head. Obviously, Maggie's distraught and all the rest of
Jeffrey
it.
Jeffrey D. Morgan!
Thank you. excellent casting choice. But yeah, I mean, it was graphic. It took what we'd seen with Abraham to a completely another level. The rest of the episode was quite standard. I mean, the whole bit about, obviously, Rick cutting Cole's hand off and, you know, threatening to do that was quite edgy of seat stuff. But then...
Coral.
But for me, Carl with that massive hat and that mop hair, and now the dead bandage over his eye. I mean, that's enough. I mean, we didn't need to see him with one arm as well.
I don't know. Just get rid of him. He just gets on my nerves.
I'm glad the mother died. She was proper irritating.
I honestly thought.
How can you be shagging about in the middle of a zombie apocalypse? What are you talking about? Oh, I'm pregnant with your baby. Oh, it's a zombie apocalypse. Stop having sex.
Okay. The Walking EastEnders.
Oh,
that would be a great crossover.
I honestly thought that Rick was going to lose his hand. I thought that it was going to be true in that respect, and Rick was going to lose his hand, but he didn't.
Herschel
died by the governor, didn't he? The governor cut his head off.
With thingy's blade.
Yeah, with
Michonne's
sword. All fairness, I mean, there was a lot of talk about this particular episode. We're going off a second. There's a lot of talk about this, but the thing is that the comics completely prophesize this. That, you know, that Glenn's death in the comics was exactly the same as it was on screen, taking away obviously the Daryl input because he's not in the comics.
So is that lazy writing then?
But well, the thing is that nobody anticipated it, because obviously the Abraham death isn't in the comics and Daryl's not in the comics in this particular segment. But Glenn being hit over the head, the eye bulging out.
I thought it made perfect sense. Again, to be honest, before I thought Abraham, I thought Glenn, because everyone was saying it wasn't going to happen because, you know, they're not going to follow the comics, Glenn's too loved, blah, blah, blah. But again, you give Maggie a child, she's pregnant. That, to me, the minute she was pregnant, I was like, yeah, Glenn's gone.
Yeah.
Because you just, they need these big drama moments to be able to continue a series. It's really boring if, like, Glenn and Maggie, they're having a kid. It's basically the storyline of, you know, Rick's kids and sister all happy, but, you know, in a shit...
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, beat that out. In a horrible world, you know. It made no sense to keep Glenn alive, again, because, you know, you need that drama, the depressing, the depravedness, the just seeing Rick just get further and further down into absolute, you know, just depressiveness.
I think, for me as well, I mean, the thing that this, you know, rounding this quick chat about the episode up...
Oh, I'm not done.
Okay, John's going to think up. But just rounding up the conclusion that, for me, the reason for having Glenn die is because of the story with Daryl. And that's one of the things that I'm most excited about, because there's no black and white text in a comic book about Daryl's story. So what the writers can do with Daryl's story is obviously exciting, and it is stuff that's going to leave us guessing. And although Glenn's death was mirrored from the comics in regards to how he died, it's interesting to see that obviously Daryl's outburst was why Negan killed Glenn. And, you know, having watched a couple of episodes already, I'm really interested to see where this takes Daryl's character in regards to the guilt or the vengeance. I mean, we know by the end of the episode that Maggie's out for blood. Maggie's obviously up for seeking revenge. So I'm really interested. I mean, all in all, it's easily been one of my favourite TV episodes for as long as I remember. Watched Walking Dead since the very beginning, and season 7, episode 1 is by far one of the best episodes. So that's me. That's all I wanted to talk about. What 2 pence do you want to throw?
Oh, no, I just... The Walking Dead just annoys me so much. Just winds me up.
It was on the 80s, so I don't like it.
No.
It was made recently.
Yes. Oh.
You can't buy a VHS.
It's not a comic book movie. I don't like it. Right. Okay, so...
Come on in. Fire the questions.
Walking Dead.
Yep.
Right, loved it from the start. Thought it was... Oh, it was new. Especially all the promo stuff with him riding the horse through the town. And it was tense. That first episode was tense. Even the bit where he hides in the tank and there's the zombie in there with him and he falls out from underneath and he sacrifices the horse, all that from season 1, episode 1. It was just absolutely brilliant. And then you had character development. And you lost a few remedial characters along the way, T-Dog being one of them.
Remember T-Dog.
T-Dog was awesome. And then you sort of... Big cliffhanger at the end of season 1. Absolutely fantastic. Season 2 rolls along. They get to Herschel's farm. Which I thought was absolutely brilliant. But then, it was like, the end of series, the end of series 2 with, is it Jeffrey DeMont, the character's name? The one who played the guy with the guy with the beard, who got shot. He was shot by the other bad guy, who was supposed to be Glenn's best friend. Glenn's best friend.
Rick's best friend.
Yeah.
I know you mean, and then he's looking out for Carl, isn't he? Yeah. He's the one who wants to be like a father figure to Andrea.
That's right, yeah. So then Shane. So then, like, Series 3 rolls round, and that's in the midst of a writer's strike. So, Series 3 for me sort of was like, you're just plodding along. And they're 50-minute episodes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? 46 minutes of utter boredom, walking through the same bit of woods, and then 4 minutes at the end of, and I'm including the credits in this, 4 minutes at the end of, ooh, that could be good, that could be good. I found myself fast-forwarding through lots of it. And then all of Series 3 was spent looking for that stupid, bloody, short-haired, grey-haired woman's child. And it was in the barn the whole time. Just look in the barn. I've just wasted 10 episodes on this. Look in the barn.
It's called...
No, it's not. It's called crap. That's what it is. So then
John
we get...
is not a Walking Dead fan.
No, no. So then we get to Season 4. Right, I won't go mad. We then get to Season 4. We then move on to the Governor's territories in Season 4. Yeah. Is that right? And the prison camp. Quite liked the stuff in the prison camp. Thought that was quite edgy. How are they going to work with prisoners? Now they're all on this. They're in, all in the same team. But then I just thought,
they
you know what?
Off way too soon, the prisoners.
Yeah, there was. But then I just thought to myself, sorry, this is boring. I love zombies. I love anything zombie. I think zombies are a fantastic concept for films, for graphic novels, for a TV series.
Remember to bring Kentucky Fried Zombie onto the show one time. It's one of the greatest, worst films you've ever seen.
It's
amazingly
awful.
Right? But
a wannabe Tarantino zombie film.
But this was just... I'm sorry, but I really have lost faith in The Walking Dead.
Well, that's fine, John. Everyone is welcome to their own opinion.
And on that, I think we'll wrap up.
Tedious load of old pap. That is. Right.
So you could have been clever there with TWD and actually come up with something, but you didn't. So anyway, Season 7, Episode 1 is phenomenal. Me personally, I think it's a brilliant TV show. Yes, it has had its dry spells. Yes, there have been episodes that have been a bit drawn out. But overall,
well,
I think it's incredible. I love it. And there'll be more to come on Walking Dead.
Okay, so next up, we're going to be looking at the new Power Rangers trailer. So, yeah.
To remind me of my screw-up?
You know, I don't think we're ever going to understand each other.
They're going to come here every Saturday just to graduate with all these other weirdos and criminals.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my...
So, this is where you come every Saturday instead of practice. Tragic.
I keep the ends out for the tie that binds.
Hey! It's a restricted area!
Guys?
There's something in there. Guys!
What is it?
Scary.
Somebody should have pointed that out. Wait, I did.
You know something happened up there, okay? I'm not the same.
I'm strong.
How strong?
I'm insanely strong.
No.
Damn!
I feel like we need to go back out there.
I'm gonna jump across with her and then you jump.
Piece of cake.
Let's go.
No,
go.
Don't jump. Jason! That's not a piece of cake!
First off, I don't know how, I think it's great, but I don't know how you can get so excited about it, considering you don't remember it first time around.